For millions of years, they ruled the Earth. And then they vanished. What really caused the dinosaurs to become extinct? Was it a giant asteroid crashing to Earth? Was it massive volcanoes erupting around the world? Was it a sudden change in climate? Or was it that they just weren't financially prepared to live out their later years? How can you avoid the dinosaurs' fate? By making U.S. savings bonds part of your retirement savings program. Ask your banker or employer. U.S. savings bonds, the safe and easy way to make sure you're financially prepared for your later years.
When she was six, her dad taught her how to ride a two-wheeler. When she was nine, he helped her explore the universe. But for all their love and attention, there was one lesson left untaught. Susie's parents never taught her about drugs. That drugs kill. When you don't say no to your kids about drugs, it's like saying yes. For a free parent's guide to drug prevention, call 1-800-624-0100.
My father taught me a lot about life, without ever saying a word. When I was a little girl, my friends were all just like me. His never were.
Hello, hello.
Didn't you bring them, George?
I thought you were.
No, I brought them last time.
Huh? You're all right. I forgot. All right, so we'll be with
you. I used to wonder, why would a Jew, a Christian, and a Muslim ever get together?
It was him!
And then I finally got it. They had a lot more in common than donuts.
Friendship. Pass it on. A message from the Foundation for a Better Life.
Hi, this is Chuck Roberts, and today we're going to discuss The American Dream and The Zoo Story by Edward Albee. These are plays a lot of us read in high school.
Yeah.
Is that where you read them?
Yeah. Yeah, actually, in my senior class play, we performed The American Dream, and it was kind of like the last big thing that the drama club did that year.
That's pretty intense for a high school to put on The American Dream.
Yeah. Yeah, it was something else, and you know, kind of reading back on it as an adult, it's kind of like, yeah, wow, I knew it was heady stuff back then, but it's kind of like, wow.
So, what'd you get more out of it when you, as an adult, what'd you get more out of now than when you were a kid?
I don't know. I think as a kid, I had my head so planted in the absurd that I failed to really realize some of the implications going on in there. You know.
Of course, it's like a savage attack on the cliches of the modern American family.
Yeah,
you've got the sort of dominating mother. Mm-hmm. You've got the emasculated father.
Oh yeah.
You've got the sort of really clever grandmother. Not sure if she's senile or just she's got one over in everybody.
Yeah, it's like the one likable character in the story.
Yeah.
Really.
Then you got Mrs. Barker, a strange character from somewhere. You know? Then you got this young man.
Mm. A young man of a dubious origin.
That's right.
And the titular character.
Yeah. And we're not quite sure what they're doing in this play, except they're waiting for someone to arrive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they think it's Mrs. Barker, but it actually turns out to be the young man, doesn't it?
Mrs. Barker,
who I kind of brings the young man in, he's going to come and carry the old lady's furniture off.
Yeah, he just kind of wanders in.
Yeah. And I noticed that...
Things fall together, or do they?
Well, sort of. It's like they... I mean, I wouldn't give any kids to these parents.
No.
Right. But they evidently had a child years before that they had. And it's really interesting, I guess, in the play, it looks like they mutilated it and ultimately murdered it.
Mm-hmm. You know?
And every bit of pain that the kid feels, his twin, who is this young man, feels it as well. It's turned him into just a really shallow shell, and he feels nothing at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Interesting thing, when I was a kid, yeah. When I was performing in the play, I actually had my head so far up into the symbolism. You'd think it would be the other way around.
Yeah.
But I failed to look at the literal implications of the story. And it's like, oh wow, this is the kid's twin.
Yeah.
And they basically murdered this kid.
I know, it's just pretty somber stuff.
Yeah.
What part did you play?
I played Daddy.
Daddy?
Yeah, I kind of did my Dick Van Dyke thing. And
so how was your performance?
I was pretty happy with it. Everyone else was pretty happy with it. They said, you need to pursue acting, Chuck. You know, you are a daddy.
That's kind of like the emasculated daddy.
Yeah, the emasculated daddy. Yeah. I don't know if how you are daddy. That's kind of like he is the village idiot.
You should get married to a domineering woman and just live in a house in the suburbs.
Yeah. I think my wife might have something to say about that. Yeah.
Did you put this on for the whole school or just for the drama class?
Basically what happened, we decided to put this play on the big senior class play, which was happening over a spread of 2 nights, was Oklahoma.
Right.
And so basically, Oklahoma played mostly. That was what everyone wanted to see. And then we kind of took the small student auditorium and put on The American Dream. And at the same time, everyone was off enjoying Oklahoma. We had, maybe 15 to 30 people come see us, and mostly family and friends.
Oklahoma's pretty safe territory for a school to put on. Yeah. But it's really interesting that the play sort of examines how, and it's true today even, a lot of families, they take these superficial family values,
mm-hmm.
and they think they're real family values.
Yeah.
And they're not, and they're totally not paying attention to what they really need to pay attention to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they kind of wander around in circles and bumble about
right.
how you can't get satisfaction anymore.
Right.
Yada, yada, yada.
It just seemed to me... It's
a lot of empty prattle.
Yeah, they're vapid characters.
Yeah.
And for me, it was like... It really did. It seemed to me like a lot of people are today, they were substituting these cliches, and they were calling them family values.
Yeah.
And they're not really family values. They're just, you know, these little silly little sayings they are grabbing onto mm-hmm. and calling them family values.
Yeah.
So did the rest of the cast, the rest of your group, know it was as radical as it was?
I had a hunch they kind of had a grasp on it, yeah.
Yeah. So what about the zoo story?
Ooh, the zoo story is a heavy piece
That's
of work.
That's an intense piece of work, isn't it?
Yeah. And... two men meet in a park, and fun and laughter ensue. Well, not really.
Yeah.
But that's a really powerful piece of work. And basically the dichotomy between these two guys who meet in the park and, you know, the one, Peter. I don't know. I tend to think of Jerry as the protagonist as opposed to Peter.
Peter's could almost fit into the American Dream.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, he's a little more fleshed out, you know.
Yeah.
The characters, most of the characters in The American Dream are kind of one-dimensional characters.
Right.
I mean, I think later on in his career, Albee would kind of breathe a little more three-dimensional kind of flesh and blood.
Like when he wrote Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf?
Yeah, I think Mommy and Daddy are kind of the prototypes that go on to become George and Martha in Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. But Peter and Jerry, Peter, you know, kind of your basic middle class family man with a lot of responsibilities and a job, and he, you know, not a bad guy, but he seems to lead a very insulated existence.
And his life is a routine to his life.
Yeah, it's a routine to his life. He has a bench in the park that's his bench, and he sits there every day and reads. And,
yeah.
And into his life wanders Jerry, and Jerry's just a mess, and Jerry has this whole kind of thing going. Peter's really more the victim. I think of Jerry as the protagonist,
right?
But at the same time, he's like this catalyst that walks into Jerry's life, and
Jerry's like a pebble that gets thrown into the stream.
Like a what?
A pebble that gets thrown into the stream. He gets thrown into Peter's pool, so to speak.
Yeah. And, this guy basically tells him this long, rambling story that he never gets to the bottom of. It's like, I went to the zoo today. Do you want to hear what happened at the zoo? And he kind of pulls Peter in. And Peter eventually kind of gets trapped in this big, crazy discussion.
Right.
Where he, up to a point, never really gets to the bottom of what happened at the zoo.
Right.
But you really kind of get pulled into Jerry's character, and he's this sad man who tells a story about his nasty landlady and her nasty dog.
That nasty dog, yeah.
And this whole almost life and death struggle he gets into with this dog, where eventually he tries to poison the dog. And the dog survives, but after that they seem to establish, I don't know if I want to say an understanding or a relationship of sorts. And it kind of foreshadows what happens at the end of the play. What can you say about a guy who can only really relate to people by forcing them, in people or animals or anything, by forcing them into these kind of life and death struggles?
Right.
It's the only way he can cut through to them and get real with them.
Yeah.
And even as a kid, that really nailed me.
I know, because I read these when I was in high school. I think everybody's, and I think the same edition, The American Dream, the Zoo Story, same illustration on the cover that when we had in high school. As I think it's probably the same one that's out now.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty radical when you read it, especially if you're radical. We had a very radical high school.
Yeah.
But it's especially radical now. And the stuff, I think, is pretty timeless.
Yeah. Well, timeless, maybe. I don't know. It's kind of interesting with Albee, because I know a lot of writers and critics have kind of tried, when he came out, tried to tie him in with, make him kind of like the American equivalent of, say, Ionesco or Genet and whatnot, with kind of the whole theater of absurdity thing.
Yeah.
I know that he preferred the term theater of confrontation.
Right.
And Albee spoke in Fayetteville a few years ago.
Oh, man, did he? I missed that.
Yeah, me too. I wasn't lucky enough to go. I had a few friends who were, and kind of an interesting thing. I mean, I think he's part of an artistic tradition that holds a mirror up to society and says, you know, here it is. You may not like what you see, but deal with it. And he pretty much said at this speaking engagement, I guess, that post 9/11, America is not real big on self-examination.
No.
And which,
not that we were real big to start with.
No, but you know, cyclically speaking, I think after 9/11, I think we really kind of pulled the wool over our eyes. You know,
yeah.
And there was a whole argument about the death of irony after 9/11, which maybe kind of plays into that.
I like to think that maybe we might be getting out of that, but maybe your economy, maybe your society has to be in a much worse shape before people really start examining themselves and their society.
Yeah. Yeah. And again, you know, all this stuff is cyclical, you know.
But Jerry used to be, reading the play, Jerry used to be a sort of well-to-do character, and then he's obviously become fallen on hard times because he's kind of seedy when he meets Peter in the park.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We're not giving anything away. Jerry eventually goads Peter or manipulates Peter into killing him.
Yeah. And kind of goads him into a fight.
Yeah. And Peter's life will never be the same again.
And pardon me?
Peter's life will never be the same again.
No. I think ultimately that's the whole thing. Is, yeah. Peter in the end is going to have to go reevaluate his whole life.
Right.
I mean, that comfortable bench where he read every day will never be his again.
No, because he killed a man there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that is kind of a real shocking initiation into a less insulated existence.
Now, in recent years, Edward Albee mm-hmm. has written a second act to this. These are both one-act plays.
Yeah.
Edward Albee has written a second act to the play.
Mm. Yeah, this is the first I've heard of that.
Yeah. I read it in an NPR interview in 2008, he said that. And if you're a professional company, you have to include the second act. But if you're just amateurs, like we ought to put on here at Cat, I guess, or whatever, you don't have to. You can include you can just do the original play. So the original, it'd be interesting to see, reading the play, I almost think, well, you don't need to put a second act on this. But Albee's point was in the interview was, my play, I can do whatever I want.
Yeah, well, true enough. I mean, from my perspective, I mean, that play seems so perfect as is.
Yeah.
And does it really need a continuation? Maybe he felt it needed a continuation, but for my money, he said everything he needed to say in that one act.
Do you think there's anything about plays like this that particularly appeal to like people in high school?
Well, I would just alienation. Maybe there are X number of alienated kids that can kind of relate to the Jerry character. With the American Dream, maybe it's kind of a punk rock thing. Here's say everything my family stood for, or here are all the bogus values that are being sold to me. I don't know that I buy them.
It's almost like a warning, too.
Yeah.
And watching Peter and watching the family in American Dream, it's like a warning, especially to younger people, don't turn out like this. Examine your lives. Examine your values.
Don't fall into this trap.
Right.
I think ultimately, you know, you blow things up into several years later. I mean, that happened with Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf.
Right.
You know, it's kind of like with all this, at the end of all this game playing, you know, the older couple telling the younger couple, here's your chance, don't end up like us.
Right. Yeah. And I think it's interesting because the teacher who introduced us to this play told us that most of us would become conservative mm-hmm. in our 30s and 40s and... all of us said, oh, you're crazy. But, you know, her words were true. You know, mm-hmm. most of the people in my class have become very conservative, I think. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to say they became as extreme as the characters in these two plays, but I think there's a part of life that makes you conservative, and I think that these are warnings to people. Don't do that. You know, mm-hmm. examine your lives.
Oh, yeah.
And we all know families, we know real families that their idea of family values are these superficial cliches.
Mm-hmm.
And when they want to trumpet family values, they just, you know, they go to the book of cliches, you know.
Mm-hmm. And meanwhile, they've got the baby buried and dismembered in the backyard.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
Not necessarily in that order, but yeah.
Well, most families anyway don't have that. But
something horrible lurks in the closet.
But those are secrets. Mm-hmm. Families have secrets they don't want to talk about.
Yeah.
And a lot of families have secrets they just don't want to talk about.
Oh, yeah.
And if those secrets came to the fore, I guess it would rip the entire family apart.
Mm-hmm.
And I think most families have those awful secrets that they mm-hmm. try desperately to keep hidden.
Oh, yeah.
So I read Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, and I saw the movie, too, with Richard Burton
mm-hmm.
and Elizabeth Taylor... George Siegel and
Sandy Dennis.
Sandy Dennis. That's a pretty intense movie.
Oh, yeah. That's something else.
And I know he's written quite a bit. I know I haven't read a lot of other stuff that he's written.
Neither have I, actually.
But this is something I think that I hope that kids in high school are still being exposed to this.
Yeah.
I worry about what kids in high school are being exposed to.
Mm-hmm.
Because I know that there are, like, watchdog groups out now and people worried that they're going to be exposed to the wrong ideas.
Yeah. Trouble with a lot of those watchdog groups, I think, is they don't seem able to really differentiate between the wrong ideas and the right ideas.
Right. No, it's they're looking for those superficial family values.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, spend some time in Oklahoma
mm-hmm.
and you'll see really people love those superficial family values.
Oh, yeah.
Or spend some much time in some of the communities outside Fayetteville, and you'll see that they cling to these superficial values, and these are values that you don't really have to think too much about. They're just do this, do that, you know, don't do the other thing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Life for Dummies.
Life for a Dummy. That's a good book. You know? I haven't read it yet, but I'm sure it's out there. Yeah. You know.
Oh, maybe we can tackle that on another book show.
There you go. 10 Commandments for Dummies.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Well, Chuck, I want to thank you very much for being on the show today.
Pleasure's all mine.
I want to thank you all for watching, and we'll see you next time, no matter what books you read. Hi, with us today. Wow.
Yes, we got a blooper.
I don't believe I did. I was doing so well. All right.
Millions of years they ruled the earth, and then they vanished. What really caused the dinosaurs to become extinct? Was it a giant asteroid crashing to earth? Was it massive volcanoes erupting around the world? Was it a sudden change in climate? Or was it that they just weren't financially prepared to live out their later years? How can you avoid the dinosaurs' fate? By making U.S. savings bonds part of your retirement savings program. Ask your banker or employer. U.S. savings bonds, the safe and easy way to make sure you're financially prepared for your later years.
When she was 6, her dad taught her how to ride a two-wheeler. When she was 9, he helped her explore the universe. But for all their love and attention, there was one lesson left untaught. Susie's parents never taught her about drugs, that drugs kill. When you don't say no to your kids about drugs, it's like saying yes. For a free parent's guide to drug prevention, call 1-800-624-0100.
My father taught me a lot about life, without ever saying a word. When I was a little girl, my friends were all just like me. His never were.
Hello, hello.
Didn't you bring them, George?
I thought you were.
No, I brought them last time.
Huh? You're all right. I forgot. All right, so we'll be with
you. I used to wonder, why would a Jew, a Christian, and a Muslim ever get together?
It was him!
And then I finally got it. They had a lot more in common than donuts.
Friendship. Pass it on. A message from the Foundation for a Better Life.
start by sharing a poem called Yes, Something Did Happen in My Childhood. I am a cook for others, shameless feeder of lovers, children, friends. I plead guilty to this destiny or daily task, this knowledge running from the succulent pores of a pork roast lodged in the aftertaste of curry stew, rising in weekly dough of warm bread. I give food as sustenance, stake well my territory. Unnerving tempers, I spoon advice to challenge hearts and minds. On cold mornings, I sit with recipe books, the joy of cooking lived and died 5 lifetimes in my hands. There are full-color gourmet photographs. I preview heady scrapings from a bowl or pan. My energies rush to the fore when no one waits or wishes to be served. I am that woman, overfiller of mouths, that plate heaper, learning late to let my eaters serve themselves, come back for seconds on their own terms. My food is not for thought, but for the belly. Belt unbuckled, every diet plan on hold. I am the writer, teacher, political activist who dreams of high praise for my apple pie, a note in the New York Times book review for my oven-baked chicken enchiladas. Yes, something did happen in my childhood. No, I cannot remember what it was.
These 3 poems are from a group of dramatic narratives about a couple named Leon and Rita. Rita is a waitress and Leon is a demolition expert. These 3 poems are mostly about Rita. This is called The Origin of Species. Rita has the wedding bell blues. That's what her Aunt Katie says. 3 sisters and she the only one unmarried. Rita said she doesn't care. Draws another plastic flute of cheap champagne to the lure of her lavender lips and winks big spiders at the groomsmen. As sister 2 speeds off to honeymoon, Rita scuffles through crisp leaves and a tux named Leon follows her tight behind to her waiting car, a napkin full of cake hot and pulpy in his hand. Pink icing on a pink tongue, she concentrates on the facts of a little sugar. Mismatched honeymooners on a silver afternoon. They steal off before the last grain of rice rains down, minds twitching and reeling from drink, color, and the missing future alibi. Inside, after the long silence that follows the plots and conspiracies of troubled people inhabiting small, unlovely rooms, she laughs at her story. Then she takes off his tie. Then she takes off. Rita loves the way her skin slides away from the eggplant gloom of the formal, pairs her down to Darwinian essentials. She notices they're keeping good time. After, she turns to spoon into the warmth as prickles from his red beard bite her shoulder. In the wide mirror by the bed, their eyes connect, a current that will not go away. She wants to turn back and start all over, those shouts and murmurs. Time again for selective amnesia, Rita slowly eases out one pin and then the next. Coils of copper hair fall onto her bare shoulders and splash against her back. Bride to his groom, she synchronizes with his rocking motion. When his wide voice has an echo, when she laughs, the sound fills the room. What Rita meant to say was, don't leave. But what happened was more of a mew. Leon thought she was about to speak French, grew suspicious of the whole thing again. The heart is pure pulsation. Rita had never noticed it until the moment of his imminent leaving. Rita notices how the last cigarette he says he'll smoke here with her in her small green room goes so much more slowly than all the others. Leon says he no longer feels safe here. But there he is, impatiently waving his arms, patiently waiting for her to say anything, something, anything, the right thing. Then he can kiss the flesh under the soft copper fluff near her ears. Then she will let him gorge on anything he wants. But words fail her, fail them in this watery half-life of winter's early evening. He reaches for another cigarette. She reaches for his arm. Rita drives cross-country, singing the blues against linear thought of yellow line and Leon. Only this language of moans coming through the headphones is relative to her experience. She passes fat, slick cattle and haystacks until her eyes glaze and see nothing. Lightning Hopkins warbles, trouble in mind, and she is forced to belt out in minor key since she never learned to dance, not on her feet. Past the two elms and uneven rocks, she thinks of those 6 weeks that were mostly like all the others. Leon came or didn't come to her, was brilliant or unwilling, struggled or splashed through her arms without being touched. Somehow, his words flashed through her like silverfish. She thought she could not bear the power of love. A twisted oak atop the western slope reminds her why she runs. What makes the engine go? Desire. 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 Only one season, then it was done. Rita believed that it was love he held concealed in his closed fist, and Leon believed it was pleasure she gave, with the trick she taught herself to please him. They were each other's rituals. Rita picks up strays along the highway, where all the lakes are deep and ancient, their trees, white stumps mired in oily black, and always the lone hawk waits above on the electric wire. Driving here, there is nowhere to call home to, no one to tell.